Ready to start? Well, good morning and welcome back to the second day of the summit.
Here's our moderator.
I'd like to welcome you to this panel, which is Nutritional Considerations for Spaceflight. There's a couple of just housekeeping deals that we might want to go over. Tonight, daylight savings time in the United States ends, and so you'll need to set your clock back 1 hour tonight when you go to bed. If not, you will be here too early tomorrow morning. You'll get here an hour early, so set your clocks back 1 hour tonight. Also, if you look on your name tag, on the back of your name tag, you'll have an indication of which of the breakout sessions you're in. I'm sure that you could work out a trade for something else, but on the front, sorry. Your breakout session is mentioned, so it's on your name tag. The first thing I'd like to do is to congratulate Mr. Abbey and Dr. Alford for this 10th year of this conference. This is a wonderful conference, and this year is certainly no exception, and I think our congratulations go to them for the great job that they've done. Nicole Stott is the moderator for this panel, and I'll talk a little bit more about her in a minute, but she's more than the moderator. She was the driving force for putting this panel together and for working hard to get speakers and for notifying speakers that they were on the panel ahead of time. And she deserves all the credit for putting this particular panel together. Food is really interesting. I think nutrition is really interesting. We need it to survive, of course, but it's one of those things where if you get too much food and nutrition, it's associated with disease. And if you get too little, it's associated with disease. And sometimes we get diseases and we need to alter diets and nutrition to optimize the care for those conditions. And for spaceflight, I'm sure that there's some consideration, as you know, we've manipulated salt and things for maybe the visual impairment issue, and that certainly for spaceflight, food and nutrition may be a factor in some of the things that we've seen, and it may be a risk mitigation strategy to change diets to improve some of the things that are seen in spaceflight. There's also a lot of social, cultural, religious aspects that come with foods and how we approach foods. And I think in a country like the United States, where we've never really had hunger to speak of, you start seeing more and more peculiarities in diet, even in astronauts that come in that have very peculiar diets that you have to contend with. Now, when I say peculiar, that means someone who eats differently than you do, usually. And it's interesting that Mark Twain once said that the secret to life is to eat whatever you like and let it fight it out once it's inside you. And I'm kind of in that category where I like to eat, and I think Mike Barrett's in that category as well. He probably should be doing the introduction as a chow hound. Well, again, Nicole is the moderator for this panel, and I've known Nicole since she came to JSC in around 98 before she was an astronaut. So I've known her for a long time, and she did become an astronaut in 2000 and had a great career there. She flew, I think, up on STS-128, down on STS-129, and in between did Expedition 20 and 21. I think Mike was probably on 20, right? Expedition 20 and 21, and then she also flew on STS-133. She's done EVAs, she's been an aquanaut at NEMO, and served at both KSC when she was doing orbital processing and JSC and a shuttle simulation, and has had a great career at NASA, and is really the reason this panel even exists. From my own standpoint, I'm very interested in listening to this. I've got my first information on space nutrition when I was in college from someone named B. Finkelstein. Now, probably General Stafford would be the only person who might know B. Finkelstein. But she ran Bee's Diner at the Mercury program and prepared the food and the nutrition for the Mercury astronauts at the very start of the space program. And I actually interfaced with her in college. And then later on, people like Rita Rapp, who many of you know, and now Vicki Claris, I've learned from a lot of people about space nutrition. And I'm really excited to be able to continue that learning today from this distinguished group.
Thanks, Richard. It's always an honor, I have to say, to be able to stand up here in front of this group. And I humbled is actually a word, too, because when it comes to this panel, when it comes to probably all of the panels that are going on during this summit, I probably have the least of, you know, the expertise and knowledge behind it. And so to be in this room with all of you who I know are looking towards our future, taking advantage of lessons learned that we have with the space program to go further and longer, it's really a pleasure to be here. I'm going to take this opportunity to shamelessly plug the artwork that's out in the auditorium or in the main area before coming in. I hope you had a chance to look at it. If not, please take the opportunity. We have a lot of beautiful paintings from kids that participated in the Humans in Space Art program that our colleague Jancy McPhee, as part of the SciArt Exchange, has brought here for us. We've seen some of this artwork here before, but she tries to cycle out different things. And I'd encourage you, all of you, to look into her program, as well as if you're interested in supporting, that would be very nice as well. And then Ian Sion, a gentleman here in the auditorium with us today. Ian is an artist, and he is the director of the Arts and Medicine program at MD Anderson. And he is the artistic genius behind the very beautiful art spacesuit that you see out in the lobby today. And that suit is put together, its name is Hope. It's put together by the individual pieces of artwork from children in treatment at the MD Anderson Cancer Center, and you'll see a smaller, flatter me out there modeling a flight suit version of the suit, which kids from MD Anderson painted directly on. We also had Kate Rubens come out to MD Anderson before she flew to station. She painted on the suit with us, and that suit is now currently on board Space Station. Kate has worn it and had a really cool interaction from space to MCC with the kids that helped paint the suit, and we're crossing our fingers that we get the suit back from station. And our third, and I think our really shining example of all this, and right in line, I think, with what we're all here today for as an International Space Medicine Summit, we've modeled our third suit after the partnership of the International Space Station program. And Ian and I had the pleasure of traveling like whirlwind trip around the world to Moscow, to Cologne, to Tokyo and Scuba, and Montreal to paint with kids in hospitals there, also with some of our astronaut and cosmonaut friends joining us to do that, and visiting the local space center, or in Moscow's case, the Cosmonautics Museum with some of those children as well. Really wonderful. All of that artwork has been brought back, and ILC Dover, along with Ian's guidance, will now quilt together the third international suit called Unity. So please take a chance to check out the artwork out there. It's very meaningful. I think when we think about this conference, the names of our suits, Hope, Courage, and Unity, I think that's what we're all about here as well. So please check it out and talk to Ian if you get a chance to. A lot of interesting projects that have come from the artwork that he's done with the children at the hospital, and I think more good things to come. All right, so food. I'll start out by introducing our panel. Several of these folks you already know, Scott Smith at the end, Oleg, and Leroy from our earlier sessions, but I'll take the opportunity now to also introduce Grace, Dr. Grace Douglas. And I'll read her bio for you. Dr. Douglas is the Advanced Food Technology Lead Scientist in the Human Health Countermeasures Element of the Human Research Program at the Johnson Space Center. Her group investigates novel food processing, packaging, product development, storage, and bioregenerative solutions to provide a food system that maintains nutrition, acceptability, and safety, and that promotes crew health and well-being on future space exploration missions. She has a BS in food science from Penn State and an MS in food science and PhD in functional genomics from North Carolina State University. Thanks for being with us, Grace. And Vicky Claris, I think most of us know Vicky. Very thankful to Vicky. Vicky is the manager of the International Space Station Food System, where she is the technical manager for the NASA contract that produces food for the ISS crews, and serves as manager for the Space Food Systems Lab at JSC. She holds a Bachelor's of Science in Microbiology and a master's degree in food science and technology, both from Texas A&M University. She has authored and co-authored numerous publications regarding space food and has received several awards, including the JSC Center Director's Commendation Award and the NASA Exceptional Service Medal. Ms. Claris is a member of the Institute of Food Technologists, the professional organization for food scientists, and has obtained her designation of certified food scientist. And as crew members, I can tell you we are very thankful to Grace and Vicky and Scott for not just the physical food that they provide us with on station, but for the very thoughtful way that they're taking care of us through the manufacture and the process of that food, and for recognizing that the food over time needs to change, whether it's the way it's packaged or the nutritional aspects of it. We're always, because of what we're learning through all of the rest of this, the medical aspects that are going on in space, we're learning that we have to be flexible and ready to change our food as well. The topics for this nutrition considerations for spaceflight panel are food as an effective countermeasure to the impacts of the space environment, and potential food solutions for the countermeasure and psychological challenges associated with longer duration space exploration missions. The focus of our discussions here at ISMS in some way come down to the fact that we're talking about flying humans in space. I think everyone here is trying to help manage those complexities of flying humans in space. And those interesting factors that go along with keeping those people healthy while they're flying in space. As a person who's been blessed to fly and eat in space, I thank you. I can tell you that the time we spent as a crew, I hope Mike would agree, the time we spent as a crew floating around the table, solving the world's problem, and eating were some of my best memories of flying in space. And I was so thankful that I was part of a crew that made a point of coming together every day to have those meals together. And I mean everyone on the crew. You know, it wasn't just the US OS side coming together and the Russian, it was the whole crew. We were a whole crew, and those meals were really, really important to us. I'm also pretty sure that everyone in this room understands the importance of flying people in space, the importance of continuing to explore further with crewed missions, and to doing that in a way that minimizes the risk to the crew, but also wonderfully helps us improve life back here on Earth. So, a lot of those complexities associated with caring for our warm, fleshy bodies in space are really just associated with our basic human needs. Food and nutrition are just two of those things. In space, as we all know, especially given the microgravity environment and those associated impacts to our bodies in that environment, food and nutrition become even more critical. Our food has to be more than just something that tastes good. Like all of the other things we implement to manage those effects on our bodies in space, our food also has to be an effective countermeasure to the effects of that environment. To be that countermeasure for future exploration missions, and I would even argue for our continued missions on space station, we seem to be at a point that's really demanding us to take not a slow evolution of our food system, but really make a revolution in our food system. We won't be able, I don't believe, we won't be able to travel to Mars with our current system. I think everybody at this table recognizes that we won't be able to do that too, that we have challenges associated with not just the nutritional side of the food, but also from the logistical standpoint of the food. And I would like to point out, really, on behalf of this panel, I hope, that already some really significant changes are happening in our food system. I mean, the reduction of sodium is just one of those. And I know I am not aware of all that is going on behind the scenes in the food lab, in Scott's lab, across JSC, actually across the world, for how we're managing our food system. But I think that when we've reduced the sodium, it's been in response to the VIP issue that we're seeing. I'd also like to think that in general, we are reducing sodium in our diet just because it's not good for us, and just because it may have implications with respect to other impacts associated with flying in microgravity. There are, of course, many challenges to making this revolution happen, and that includes not just those nutritional aspects, but the psychological and logistical aspects as well. And so today, to kick off our discussion, I'd like to ask each of our panel members to share just a couple minutes about why and what they see as the main challenges for our space food system and what we're doing right now to revolutionize that system for our future exploration missions. And Leroy, can we start with you, please?
Okay, thanks, Nicole. Well, it's a pleasure to be on this panel. I will agree that food is a big deal, so a big thank you to Vicky, whom I've known for many years, and Grace, and everyone else on the team here. You know, it's interesting, when we go fly on shuttle, or when we flew on shuttle, we had these 1 to 2 week missions, and just pretty much everyone lost weight. I think Mark Lee's the only one that didn't lose weight. But I think that has a lot to do with not so much a statement about the quality of the food. It was more that your bodies are changing. And so, you know, I think you have less appetite, and maybe your body's metabolizing differently and things like that for the first 2 weeks. And generally, I think what we find on station is after we start flying station flights is everybody came back, most people came back pretty much at their normal weight. And so I think you go through that 2 week dip, and then your body adapts after about 3 or 4 weeks, and you kind of start leveling out. Food is a huge deal psychologically. You guys, I think most people here know that Salajan and I endured a food shortage, and that was a pretty big deal. Our buddies on Expedition 9 kind of got into our food. And to make matters worse, we were blamed for overeating, because what happens, you take one of those food containers, and you take half of those packages out, the rest of it expands to fill, right? And it looks like it's full. And so we were flying through food containers during the first part of our mission. And so we were initially blamed for our own woes. I'll tell you what, we dealt with it. We had plenty of calories on board because they were kind enough to leave us with all kinds of desserts, candy bars, and crackers. But we didn't eat all those. We had about 1,200 calories of real food a day for about 3 or 4 weeks. Each lost 5 or 10 pounds, which I guess, you know, everybody, nobody has sympathy for that. Everyone I know says they want to lose 5 or 10 pounds. One of the things, and it kind of gets into what we were talking about yesterday about the psychological effects of long-duration space flight. You look forward to eating. You look forward to meals, like Nicole said. There's a table aboard ISS, and the Americans, we didn't understand why there's a table on board in zero G, but it became clear once we got up there. And as Nicole said, we gather around the table. That's what you do here on Earth. You gather around a table and you share a meal together, and that really is comforting. It's something that that adds a lot of psychological support. The tension with the ground, you know, we told the ground, Salajan and I, we decided we're going to deal with this with humor. And so we would float around the station talking about how full we were and, you know, how, gosh, we couldn't eat another bite. And we encouraged the ground to send us jokes. And initially they sent us some pretty great jokes. You know, in fact, one of the best ones came from flight medicine. One of the gals in flight medicine sent up, what do you call two astronauts in dinner jackets? Hopeful. But then the ground, in their infinite wisdom, and in fact it was CB management, cut it off, said no jokes. You know, said, oh, great, so you're going to take away our psychological support for dealing with this. Thanks, guys. Thanks a lot. Anyway, as far as the future of food, I agree, and I'm certainly not an expert on food and how you package food for the radiation environment, or how you formulate it, and what's going to be best for a long duration flight to Mars, things like that. But clearly, I agree, something's probably going to have to change. But more from the technical side, from the psychological side, I can tell you, I did wonder, you know, we have a pretty remarkable variety of food, including, especially when you throw in the Russian food and then the international food from Europe and Japan. Well, Canadians are like us, so. But I wondered if I would be able to get myself to eat enough to kind of maintain my body mass, which is important. And what I found is that after about 3 weeks, my mind played a trick on me. And I don't know if the other guys, I haven't talked too much to the other guys about this, but, you know, the food is okay. It's pretty good. You know, it's kind of like, gosh, am I going to really be able to eat enough or want to eat enough without forcing myself? And after about 3 weeks, something interesting happened. I think you realize that's what you've got. And suddenly it becomes really delicious. And you start really looking forward to it and looking forward to mealtimes. And then it became the same situation on the ground. You just got to kind of limit yourself so you don't gain weight. I'd be interested to hear certainly the experts' opinions on what we have to do to the food system to technically make it be able to last in the radiation environment in the longer durations and, you know, what needs to be reformulated to handle those challenges.
Thank you, Leroy. Grace?
So the two biggest challenges that we do have with our food system we're working on right now, and that is the nutrition and acceptability for long duration. So our current food system on the International Space Station, we don't have refrigerators and freezers for. We have about 1.5 to 3 year shelf life, depending on what the foods are. There are a couple of food items that will last 5 years, but we're losing the acceptability of the food, so people just wouldn't want to eat them, or we're losing certain nutrients in the foods at critical levels. And so as we look forward to long duration, we're trying to figure out methods to stabilize those nutrients and to also stabilize the acceptability of the food. And so there's a couple of ways we can do this. One of the ways would be to have refrigeration and cold storage on these missions, and what would that need to look like? What temperatures would we actually need to have to stabilize it? How much of that food system would we need to stabilize? And will refrigeration get us to the lengths we need, which is 5 years? So right now, they talk about pre-positioning food on Mars. And at that point, the food system could be up to 3 years old by the time the crew begins consuming it. And right now, that's the limit of our food system. So that is a big challenge for acceptability and for nutrition. So acceptability is actually a very big part of that, because even if we were to stabilize the nutrients in the food, if our crews weren't going to consume enough calories or consume the right foods because those foods were becoming unacceptable, they could have risk for both body mass loss, muscle mass loss, and bone loss, and also micronutritional deficiencies. And if you look through history, one of the biggest micronutritional deficiencies that was a huge issue in exploration was vitamin C. So that's still an issue now. We see vitamin C decreasing drastically in most of our foods within 2 years. And at 3 years, really the only food that's maintaining its vitamin C very well is a dried beverage like Tang. So you could say, well, every crew member should just drink the Tang, right? The issue with that is there are some, you know, as you go along on these missions, if you don't like a food and you don't want to eat it every day, now you have to eat that food every day, or, you know, it could become an issue. You know, you want to have some variety to get the nutrients you need. Additionally, Tang would just have vitamin C or just specific nutrients that you added to it, whereas whole foods have thousands of phytochemicals we're only beginning to understand the effect that they're having on our body, that our microbiomes are using those phytochemicals and processing those in ways that are being used throughout our bodies. And so it's very important that we have whole food systems that are stabilized, that the crew continues to want to eat all types of foods in those systems, and they're getting full nutrition, not just a supplement with certain nutrients in it. So those two things, acceptability, which includes variety. If you don't have variety that crew members would want to eat over time, how does that variety change? That becomes very important. And nutrition are two very big issues. I would mention that bioregenerative systems, we have looked at those somewhat. So that would be like growing plants and processing those into meals on the mission or on a surface mission. While we are looking into how we would start implementing that, we are starting with pick and eat food systems. So you might have seen the lettuce was eaten on a previous ISS mission. We're trying to increase that. However, on initial Mars missions that would be exploration missions, they would likely still need to have mostly a processed food system prepackaged like we have now. The crew time for a bioregenerative system is pretty significant, and also then you have risk of food scarcity. And radiation was brought up. Right now, we don't know what deep space radiation would do to the nutrition and acceptability of our foods. So we do know that radiation sources here on Earth can have drastically different effects on different nutrients. Some foods are irradiated here on Earth at low levels to stabilize them, but they only use gamma radiation or they use E-beam, and so the sources are very limited. And in general, we have a couple of foods that are irradiated in our food system right now, but those are deep frozen for the irradiation process, and they do not last 5 years. So those would be the concerns going forward to figure out what that radiation would do to confirm that it would not be an issue on these missions.
Thank you, Grace.
Vicki?
Grace is correct in talking about the degradation issues that we have. So the thing about it is, from a microbiological perspective, we can create a food system that will last the 5 years that we need, or maybe seven, because now we're hearing about the possibility that the cargo vision, the cargo vehicle that prepositions that food will be solar powered rather than chemical powered, meaning it would take longer for it to get there. And that, if that's the decision, then that means the food they eat on the return trip would be even older than the 5 years that we've been banking on so far. So we can make food safe from a microbiological perspective, but all the things that Grace talked about in terms of degradation are a potential issue for quality as well as for the nutritional content. And those, a lot of those are based on chemical reactions. And so when Grace talked about the possibility of refrigerators and freezers, that would not be that we're really trying to come up with a frozen or refrigerated food system. It would be that we're trying to use the freezers and refrigerators to decrease those chemical reactions to help extend the shelf life over time. We can't really plan on refrigerators and freezers for food that has to have that to maintain the health of the food or the safety of the food, because there's too much potential that if those failed, where would you be? So we would use it to help extend the shelf life. And one of the topics here is about how to use food as a countermeasure. And I think that one of the things to consider, and Grace did touch on this, is the psychology of the food, and certainly Leroy did. Because I think when you talk about maintaining crew health over a mission like this, a three-year mission, I think that crew morale is actually going to be, trying to maintain crew morale is actually going to be a countermeasure to potential health issues. So having crews that are in good spirits and top morale will help them from a health perspective as well. And I think over the time that I've been here, I started very early in the shuttle program when the missions were short. I can attest that during the shuttle program, there was little emphasis on food from a psychological perspective. There were very few crew members who felt that it was critically important to that short duration in space. But as our crew members went to stay on Mir, they quickly learned that when you're up there for a long time, food takes on a much more significant importance from a psychological perspective. And so it was interesting for me to see over time how this has evolved, because early on, the shuttle crew members didn't think it was important. When they went to MIR, they started thinking it was important, and then that word got back to their fellow crew members in the astronaut office that food is important when you're on. You know, you really need to give some thought to what you're taking with you when you're on these long duration missions. And then they had to turn around, the astronauts had to turn around, and we had to educate management, because most of the management in the space station program had been shuttle managers. And when issues came up where crew members were on orbit, I don't have my coffee, I don't have my bonus containers that I was promised, and that became an issue, the station managers were like, whoa, wait a minute, we've never heard about food as an issue before. Why all of a sudden is this a problem? So it's been an evolution, and now the space station management realizes how important, from a psychological perspective, and to the performance of their crew, that food can be. And so now, you know, they are carefully monitoring and carefully asking us all the time, are we sure they're going to have their coffee? Are we sure they're going to have this? Are we sure they're going to have that? We don't want them to have any shortages. So the psychological perspective is very, very important for maintaining crew health as well, I believe.
Thank you, Vicki. Oleg.
Yeah, hello. Okay, I completely agree with my colleagues about the all aspects of the food system we had on ISS. And this food system evolution was from the very beginning when we came to the program with Russian's food system and U.S. food system, and finally now we have international joint food system for whole station. Even the formally we divided in two segments and two systems and two colors of food containers. We're still running as one crew and sharing our food between us, and every crew decided how to use the food and bonus containers, and everything. And of course, the main aspect is a psychological aspect of the food, of eating, because having a dinner or supper, dinner, or breakfast together is very important. And it's, from my perspective, this is the only way when the whole crew voluntarily comes together to sit together around or fly around the table, even in the Russian or U.S. segment, and talking around all the news about their life, about everything. And food is very important. And again, if you take a look on their post-fly reports, no one system has such big amount of remarks, complaints, recommendations. It's only about the food. No one, because I don't remember even once when the crew was happy about the food. Always saying, "Yeah, we need. Okay, let's need run out the coffee or the." Something is taste not good, or amount of food is not right, so or package is not right, and it's very important. And I think we're pretty in good shape now for low Earth orbit flying, but we need to start thinking about the future, about the long duration, not long duration, but flying toward to the our other planets, to the Mars. And I think its approach should be a little different, because again, having their food, which should be placed in freezer, bring us to the idea that the freezer becomes more critical system in a space vehicle. If something happened with freezer, no food, no crew, no success mission. Maybe, and again, having a big variety of food for long flights, it's good from psychological aspect, but it's not good from the managing the system. So it's difficult to do for flying toward to the Mars, for example. Again, it's not having this food system like we have now, when we have first we have resupply system, so we all food will bring with us, and take with us and comes to there and but maybe start thinking how to recyclable food system, maybe to grow something on the station or having something that can reproduce on the station or even on the planet, because we're talking now only about how to reach the planet, but not talking about how to keep life on the surface of planet, on the moon, on the surface of the Mars. You got different gravity, different, I say, greater. Different needs, different like physical activity. So maybe different contains of food, nutrition, different nutrition must be there. And from my perspective, very interesting aspect is a trash. You know, this on the space station, we have the ability to throw away all our empty cans, packages, plastic, everything put somewhere in the container, put in the progress, and VVT and remove from the station. But during the long flights, we won't be able this opportunity, and we need to bring our trash with us together. It means the smells, it's a microbiology aspect, and there will be psychological not very good, it smells not good. For example, we had during my second flight, we had a progress which was docked for 200 days, almost 200 days to station, and it smells like garbage. Right. So and we ask the ground, okay, and mostly from empty cans, the trash from the food. So mm-hmm. And we put just imagine how it could smells if you have your garbage bag for 6 months or 4 months on your apartment in your house. So finally, we asked ground, say, okay, we're ready to work all weekends to put everything, all trash, all everything to the progress and seal the hedge. So and forget about this this progress. Yes, so it's interesting and very important aspect from my view. So it's yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Scott.
Well, it's very important that we differentiate between food and nutrition.
Yes.
And I work with a nutritional biochemistry lab, and left to our devices, we could come up with, and we've actually proposed what I would consider an optimal diet for spaceflight. And that's based on what we know in the field of nutrition right now. Which is continuing to be a growing field. It's the books aren't closed. But there are a number of things that we could do to provide a better diet than we do right now. In terms of, you know, when we look at this, for throughout the history of spaceflight, we had conceded that, or many had conceded, that weight loss was inevitable and that people were going to lose weight and it wasn't that big a deal. That they'd regain it after flight, so we didn't need to worry about it. And in 2008, when we flew the ARED, and through encouragement and through, I think, the fact that they were working harder, we had crews that were eating better in terms of maintaining calories, maintaining their body mass. And for the first time in 50 years of flying humans in spaceflight, we saw people come back with the same bone mineral density that they left the planet with nothing other than maintaining their weight, eating well, they had good vitamin D status, and they exercised hard. So the idea that we're just going to let loose people lose weight and that's not going to have an impact is first line evidence that this is serious. Now, again, from a nutrition perspective, there are things we could do along the same lines that would help muscle, that would help cardiovascular health, that would help protect against radiation. We've already heard about the psychology and morale of food in and of itself. And when we look at performance, the idea that nutrition would support that is significant. And I think, you know, going back to the baseline question of what are the challenges that we have, I would say rather bluntly, the challenge is convincing vehicle managers and program managers and the crew office that nutrition in and of itself could be a countermeasure. Because while the talk is great and this all sounds really nice, when push comes to shove, food weighs a lot. Food's expensive to develop. And the first thing they do is push back on, we can't fly that much food. How much can we cut? Can you take less water? Can you eat less calories? People always lose weight, so why don't we fly less food than we know we need? And that's the wrong way to go. These guys are working a project right now that they've been boxed into to figure out a way to replace a meal with a bar, okay? Because they've been forced to reduce the mass of the food system by 10%. Now, nobody said, is there a way to make the nutrition better or to feed people better or to optimize nutrition as a countermeasure? The task was to lower the mass of the food. And as long as that's the mentality we're going to have, that's the food system we're going to go to Mars with. And when we look back historically, no matter where you want to look at, we heard yesterday about Lewis and Clark. If you look at the polar expeditions, you look at folks that sailed out of Europe, there are books written on each of those cases on how important nutrition was. And when nutrition didn't work, when you ran out of a single nutrient, things went horribly wrong. If you look at the age of sail between Columbus's trip and the invention of the steam engine, scurvy, vitamin C deficiency, killed more than 2 million sailors. Killed more sailors than all other causes of death combined. And that's because we didn't have enough vitamin C. Now, there's not a nutrient that your body needs that you can do away with for 3 years on a Mars mission that you're not going to run into a major problem if you don't have enough in the food system, if it's not stable in the food system, if the food's not being eaten. It's going to be a bad trip. And we need to start paying attention to that before it gets too far.
Thank you, everyone. I really, I love the mix of ideas that came out of this. And I love how we started and how we ended, because I think I think we could have a whole conference on nutrition and food. And I think it could drive out the implications of how our exercise equipment supports us as a countermeasure, what we have to do in terms of cleaning our air, the CO2 issues we have, all of these things that are about keeping the human being alive in space. I think we can draw it back in some way to the way our bodies are processing our food and the nutritional aspects of that food. And we have, I think, power to overcome a lot of these things, power to proactively take advantage of nutrients in our food that could help us reduce the amount of bone that's sloughing off in our bodies that's putting us at potential risk for kidney stones, you know, perturbing what the environment is already doing to us, and helping through our food and the nutritional aspects of it to minimize those risks, to minimize those implications. And so I'd like to ask you guys to think about, you know, Leroy, there's very much a psychological aspect to what went on with what you and Salajan experienced. And Vicky, I love the comment about, the morale. I think the morale aspect of this is huge. And keeping the food in a condition that allows it to be edible and nutritional is a really important factor as well. When we look at our food system and we think about the psychological aspects, so if you were put in a position where essentially you might have been the crew that had to eat the bars, the entire time to get the calories that you needed. But in reality, with the calories on their own, are they enough to sustain a healthy system? I think it's one aspect of it. You could have eaten candy and the little Debbie Brownie things, you know, for months and gotten probably the calorie intake that you need. But would you have been a healthy human being because of that?
We would have done it, and it would have been fine. We would have gotten enough calories, and we would have, you know, dealt with whatever happened. But no, we would not have been nearly as happy. Of course, we weren't that happy to begin with. They tell me at some point I won't be bitter anymore. But
we were hoping this would be the intervention.
No, but seriously, it is a huge deal to, you know, have a nice meal at the end of the day together. But if push comes to shove, you know, we could have eaten in those, I know in the Russian survival system, we have these super densified little...
Barbie breads.
Not even breads. They're those, you remember from survival training, those little concentrated little chunks, you know, that have like a million calories in them. And so we could have, you know, we could have eaten those and survived. Now, I would imagine on an expedition to Mars, you're going to have things like that that are going to be stabilized and can have a very long shelf life for emergencies when something does happen to your food, that you do have the calories and something that's stabilized that you can survive on. But that certainly wouldn't be the first choice.
No, and I think the argument could be made that maybe calories on their own is not, I mean, that's not the sole driver in what we should be, you know, considering our food system to be, whether they're concentrated or in, you know, a Snickers bar. I mean, that should not be how we're looking at, you know, sugar should not be the way we, you know, solely generate our calories. So I think this is across the board, and Scott, I want you to speak to this, is when we look at nutritional content in the food and start thinking about things like, I know we could go, you know, a lot of us use sci-fi as our examples for, you know, what we might do in the future with everything from, you know, our rockets to the kind of food we eat. And, you know, I think about Star Trek and the little food replicator, and none of that even came out looked like, you know, food that we know. At, you know, blue cubes or whatever, and but there's got to be some like place in between there, in between the concentrated food cube and being able to send and maintain and logistically support kind of the packaged food system that we have now, and that's both in the trip, you know, to the destination as well as once we get there. And I guess Scott, if we could start with you, what, you know, where do you think we're at in terms of either supplementing the food system that we have today or really radically shifting to things like presenting food in a different way that's maybe psychologically based on colors in the room or colors of the food or the smells that are piped in to the room? I mean, I know chefs are doing that right now in restaurants in a way that's trying to revamp the way we think about food and nutrition. Is that something we need to be considering in spaceflight as well?
Well, you know, I always hearken back when we were preparing for station, and Helen can attest to this. I remember we were having the same fights for trying to get freezers and refrigerators on station, and we argued that the food system would be better. And I remember one of the engineers saying, "Look, you could eat dog food for 90 days and get away with it," and you probably could. I haven't tried, I don't want to try, but you probably could. And the question becomes, is that what we want? Is that for people that were looking to perform in a very hostile environment for a very long period of time, that, you know, where morale is going to be tough enough as it is that what we want? And I, you know, I tell people all the time, you know, if we ever get to the point where it's the Jetsons and you get your pill that you pop in, from a psychological point of view, I think we need to be very concerned about that. First of all. Second of all, I think, you know, we Americans in the room always want the quick answer. So whenever a study comes out and says that, you know, people that eat vegetables that are high in vitamin E get less cancer, everybody starts taking vitamin E pills because vitamin E is going to cure cancer. And we find out 10 years later that, well, vitamin E pills don't cure cancer. And some people, it makes cancer worse. I think, as Grace mentioned before, that the fruits and vegetables in particular have thousands and tens of thousands of phytochemicals that we do not understand. And the idea that you could somehow extract or boil down what you need and eat, you know, eat your dog food with a special space vitamin, I don't see that working. I think we're still a long way away from that. I'd put that in the same boat what we talked about yesterday with you know, genetically modifying individuals. Someday will that happen? Yeah. Am I going to see that day? Probably not.
And Grace, with the things and Vicky, the things that you guys are doing in the food lab right now. I mean, I know just from the first time I flew to the second flight, and then coming back and doing the food tastings the way that you guys are doing it now, which I think very thankfully incorporates more than just an evaluation of the taste of the food. I mean, I think crew members are being presented with, you know, information about the food in a totally different way than we ever were before. And I think that's a very reassuring thing. Because I can tell you, I went in, you know, went into this with the idea that I just trust that this is the best food I could ever possibly be eating. It's doing what it needs to do to counteract the, you know, the implications of the environment I'm going to be in, and just go with it. And it's been interesting to me to talk to you guys and to find out over time the struggles that you have in the lab for overcoming, you know, some of the things that are built, you know, that are built into the food system right now. And the fact that you're, I see the step-by-step improvements that are happening with respect to informing the crew. And I think that's a huge thing, because choices is a wonderful thing. And I love that we're even looking now, I think, in the food system to being able to support crew members who have food sensitivities in some way. I imagine is going to be difficult, but but the fact that we're even considering doing that is huge. And if we continue to take that, you know, here's how we can improve this food system approach from the nutritional and the kind of form and logistical standpoint, I think we're going to be able to get to that medium. And I think more as we bring together, you know, the different groups that are looking at the food and the aspects of it, the better it's going to be. Can you guys tell us a little bit about, in the food lab right now, what kinds of kind of cutting edge, like, you know, things that you would consider to be the stuff that crew members and this audience might not know about that's going on to help manage that challenge for the future?
So there's two major emerging food processing technologies that we're looking at. And so, Grace, if you want to take one, I'll take the other. If you want to talk about high pressure, I'll talk about microwave sterilization. So you want to do that?
Sure. So we are looking at some of the emerging food processes. We're looking at high pressure, which is a technology that uses very high amounts of pressure and less heat. So heat is the thing that you're destroying the nutrition, you're destroying acceptability with. When you buy canned food in the grocery store, you can see this. And some of you might be buying now the tuna that's in the pouches rather than that's in the cans, and you see a major improvement. And part of that is you have to heat. So cans are commercial item or commercially sterile items. And so you're basically killing all the bacteria that would be in there that could grow. And they have to heat to the center point of that product to create that commercial sterility. And that point, they're cooking the outside of that product more than the inside. So cans that are just in a retort, under pressure, cooked to 250 degrees, they have to cook through the outside to the inside. And so it's a pretty damaging process to the food. The pouches are much better because they're so thin and you can cook to that internal point much quicker. However, you're still getting a lot of heat processing on those foods with a retort. And so the new processes that are coming out, such as the high pressure, are using a lot of pressure to destroy the microorganisms and very little heat. Right now, the high pressure process is used quite a bit in the grocery stores. So you find it in refrigerated food. So right now they have some new refrigerated items that are sold at all the local grocery stores here just recently that are high pressure processed. However, they haven't really gotten to a point yet where they can mass produce commercially sterile products that don't need refrigeration. So that is something that we could potentially use in the future. And the impacts are amazing because you're not heating that product up so much. You have much better color. You have much better texture quality of those products. However, right now, we don't even really know how those products would be stable over a five-year mission. So are you going to retain those initial qualities? That is one of our concerns. If we can get a better product initially, do you retain that initial quality improvement for the length of a Mars mission, so for 5+ years? So that is one of the things that we are looking at. And
so microwave sterilization is another emerging food processing technology, and similar, it does pretty much apply the same amount of heat that a retort process would, but it does it in a much shorter time span, and so it also does many of the things that high pressure does. So in theory, you end up with a higher quality product initially. So you have a higher nutritional content because you have applied that heat over a shorter time. You've got higher nutrition, better texture, better color initially. And so as that degrades over time, you should get a longer shelf life before you get to the point of it being unacceptable, either from nutritional content or quality perspective. So we and the military both have big interest in both of these emerging technologies. And so those are being looked at. And one of the biggest challenges with both of these is how to scale them up and make them to where they can be a continuous process, which is what you really need in order to be able to mass produce these items. And so part of the problems with microwave sterilization and with high pressure processing are packaging. What kind of packaging material can you use? The traditional packaging material for the retort that we're using is the MRE pouch, and there's evidence under high pressure that it delaminates. And so there's some challenges both from a logistical and mechanical perspective to scaling these processes up, and also from the perspective of what materials will withstand these new processes. So that's a big problem, but we're looking at that. Grace's group is doing a lot of studies on shelf life in terms of nutritional content and which nutrients do we have to be concerned with and over time degrading, and also which foods do these nutrients hold up better in, because the data shows that the matrix that food is in makes a big difference on how that nutrient survives over time.
Interesting. So Oleg, I think all of us who've flown on station would agree that there are a lot of really wonderful things about the international partnership that goes into the space station. And one of those, I think, is the mix of foods that we do have on board. That, you know, that we have food products from the Russian program, we have food products from the European and Japanese program, and we even do get a couple from the Canadians as well thrown in there every now and then. Maple is usually associated with it in some way. But I think that's part of this morale psychology side of things. That's a big deal, and to have the opportunity to share food that way was really, really fun, and just part of the kind of the joy, the delight of the experience of being in space, that whole floating around the table thing, and the fact that we shared foods was, and I think that you mentioned, it's part of what happens now. It's one food system for the most part. What within the Russian program do you see happening now? Or have you seen changes over time in the way food products are presented, introduction of new foods into the system, and how the nutritional aspects of that is being considered as well?
Okay, so that's Russian food system also passed through some modification and some changes during the ISS life. So that's now, you know, where new commercial foods now included and to the standard food containers in the Russian side, and this is for sure, there's influence from U.S. food system to the Russian. So, you know, that traditionally the Russian food system is very conservative. They were almost from the meal station. We have almost the same packages, the same sets of food, the same containers. Everything is pretty old. But now with Russian food system includes some commercial foods and international foods, and again, we're working about the change the packages for food, and maybe to modify the container. So it's not a stable system. It's when all is running out, running in difference. But I always wonder, how we can do this? That food tastes different in lab and in space.
I was very thankful for the Tvorog every morning for breakfast. Scott, in all of this, I'd just like to know, if you could have the perfect world with the nutrition blended into the food, the kind of food that we would have that maintains that nutritional content and is the countermeasure to the things that are happening to our bodies in space. Do you have a vision of that, of what that would be from your standpoint in the nutritional studies associated with?
Indeed, we've tried to implement this and haven't gotten very far. And some of the issue, some if not all of the issue, is logistical, because the vehicle traffic with station is not reliable enough to get food to a specific crew member. So we send the same thing to everybody. But from a nutrition point of view, I'd look for things like more fish, more sources of omega-3 fatty acids. We need more fruits and vegetables. And in short order, that's the key things that we're lacking right now. And I think the other push is we need a way to personalize this per crew member. Because we often hear stories of, the crew that's up there now that'll call down and say, look, we've got 4 containers full of grits. Nobody's going to eat it. Can we throw it out? And the next crew member will say, wait, don't throw out the grits because I like grits. And there's a lot of examples like that where what one crew hates, the next crew loves. So the idea that you could change the food system based on input from a small number of people is very, very difficult to do. And what we had proposed is augmenting the nominal food system, which is standard, with foods that each crew member, that would be designed for each crew member. So in trying to get more fruits and vegetables into crews, the old, if you like broccoli, we'll get you broccoli. If you don't like broccoli, we'll get you asparagus. If you don't like asparagus, we'll get you something else. But the idea that we're going to fly broccoli for everybody doesn't work for everybody. So that's where it gets very, very tough.
So how do you, and for anyone, how do you think we get, because these are challenges we're having with space station right now. And when we start thinking about traveling for many months to another planet, and what I think is a smaller vehicle than the space station, how do we manage this? We're not resupplying that mission over those months just from the starting point to the end point. I don't know if there is.
I think in part,
cubicles.
That's I know those little sponges that you add water to, and then it expands into your plate of food. I don't know.
Well, in part, I think we're going to need to know who the crew are, mm-hmm. before we build the exact food system, so that you can avoid just that. I mean, so if you've got a crew member that wants to eat oatmeal every day for breakfast, then you pack it of oatmeal.
So are we designing into our transportation system enough logistical support to contain the food for?
Well, there's got to be logistics for food. I mean, again, we will fly food. The question is, what food will we fly?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And the problem is, like, when we started station, on shuttle, we always had a 100% personal preference menu. Crew members would come in, tell us exactly what they wanted, and that's what we packed. And that worked great on shuttle, because the food and the crew member never got separated. We tried that on station early on, and it was a disaster, and mostly from a psychological perspective, because in order to assure that a crew member gets exactly what they've chosen for a 6-month stay, you're looking at approximately 70 containers of food that you have to get to that crew member in the right time frame. And so we found out very quickly that wasn't going to work on station. And crew members came back and complained loud and long, you promised me I was going to get what I selected. Part of the time I was up there, I had to eat somebody else's food and they had terrible taste in food. I mean, it really was a big issue. And so the first time that ATV was going to fly, we knew ESA wanted the food like a year in advance of the mission. And we knew after we shipped the food to Europe that the launch would slip because it had already slipped numerous times. So we put together a standard menu and went to the astronaut office and said, look, since we have no clue who's going to be on board when this food arrives, let us use the standard menu for ATV. And much to my surprise, they came back and said, not only do we want you to use it for that, we want you to use it from now on. And so that's when we instituted the standard menu, and that was with increment 16. So we've been using it ever since. We've tweaked it occasionally with input from the astronaut office, but we did agree to let them augment that with what we originally called bonus containers. Now we call them crew-specific menu containers, so they get some containers with their own names on them, but it's a smaller quantity so that we can manage to actually get them there at the right time, fingers crossed, no cargo vehicles blowing up type of thing. We can get them there. So what we're looking forward to, and Scott hasn't mentioned today, is the app that they have on orbit, the ISS Fit, that will give us real day-to-day data of what is being consumed and what is not being consumed by default, so that we can make some adjustments and tweaks to the standard menu that we're using on Space Station. Right now, we don't have a consensus. Scott did mention the fact that, you know, what one increment hates, the next increment loves. So we need exact data. And right now, a lot of it, all we really have is a lot of anecdotal data from crew members about what they liked and didn't like. So we really are looking forward to being able to get data from this app that we can use to create a consensus to change the standard menu.
And one of the other things to note is that from the ISS menu to, or from the shuttle menu to the ISS menu, there were about 70 food items that were developed and added. And that was partially because that variety that was available for shuttle turned out not to be enough variety for the 6-month missions. And as we go forward to missions that last up to 3 years, that's going to be another concern, because part of it is, we talked about logistics, they can only have certain containers open at a time because that's the space they have to open those containers. And right now that has about 200 different items in it. And they pick their food, they pick from those items to assemble the meals. However, we can't really have more containers open than that. So logistically, we're kind of limited to that right now. If we go on a mission to Mars, are we still limited to 200 items open at once? And then do we have to evolve those items over time? So one of the things we're also looking at is developing a wide variety of acceptable foods so that crew can have some choice in that. Right now, if they really like one type of food, they might get it once in 7 days. And so they can augment that with their crew preference menus by adding the food they really like to those containers. But we are trying to increase, as Scott said, the vegetables and fruits. So can we have more variety of highly acceptable vegetables and fruits? On Earth, we don't eat as many vegetables and fruits that are fully processed as we might eat fresh. They don't have that fresh option. So developing a wide variety of appetizing fruit and vegetable items that they can choose from over time, and how should that variety change over time, is very important. The other thing is, we talked a little bit about, should the crew be known? If we send the food ahead, that's still a huge challenge, because if it lands on Mars 3 years ahead of the mission, and then a crew member gets changed before that mission, now they would once again have to eat for 3 years the food that another crew member asked for, unless we planned to have food available for extra crew members if something like that did happen. So that could be a huge challenge. And then if a crew member starts to consume more of one item, that limits what's now available for the rest of the crew to consume. And so if they're selecting more fruits and vegetables and some of the other crew are getting more meats, now you start having an issue with, are they getting the right nutrition? So how to balance that food system, how to have enough up there so that crews can choose what they want and still get the nutrition they need, is a huge challenge, because we do expect in that system at some level there's going to be food that they're not going to consume. If you expect that they have to consume everything, then they do start picking the foods they like or saving the foods they like, or maybe some crew members are eating into foods without the other crew members' knowledge. We've seen things like that. So in crews like Bioplex, which, you know, that was probably much, that was not as vetted as, you know, we would do for spaceflight. However, they did have a lot of issues with food stealing and things like that. So, you know, those are things you don't want to see as concerns as you go on these longer missions, that you would have limited food where it becomes a concern to crew members as they go into deep space and they have a psychological challenge with a system that's not adequate.
See, Nicole, I'd like to make a comment. I think it's a different mindset if you're going to go to Mars, mm-hmm. okay? I mean, if you go to station, and the analogy I would use on the Earth is you go to station, it's kind of like going to, say, Antarctic station, and you're there, and you're camping for 6 months. But if you're going to the pole, if you're going on this big, you know, you've got to trim down what you take. You're going to have a different mindset. And so if I'm flying to Mars, I'm going to have a whole different mindset than if I'm going to go orbit for 6 months. And so in that case, you know, my mindset, food, I think we're in violent agreement, is important, but I'm going to put up with a lot more, you know, to go to Mars. And so I think we don't have to have, you know, people aren't, well, hopefully the people we choose to go won't have this mindset that I should be able to get whatever I want, you know, whenever I want on a Mars trip. Whereas for station, that's being resupplied, you know, more routinely, and you're already kind of in a fixed place, maybe there's more of an expectation of that.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I completely agree with Leroy, and just have the question again for a week and engage. Okay, the understanding in theory, how are we going to do, for example, for Mars, for 6 months flight to Mars. But are you going to change your or create this food system and test it during the ISS flight? Because it's only one unique opportunity to try it during the ISS age. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we do have plans. Grace, you want to talk about the bars and how you're testing those? Yeah.
We do, we are just finishing up a study right now where, so Scott had mentioned that we had to reduce the mass of the food system by 10% for the upcoming Orion missions. And we were doing that by developing 700 to 800 calorie meal replacement bars. And these were nutritionally balanced to replace a meal. However, we've not previously required crew members to eat a meal replacement like this in previously, and so we wanted to know if we were to implement this into the food system, would it start increasing the risk that crew members would consume less food because they would just avoid eating this every single day? And so the idea was we would implement this every single day. Every single day they'd have to eat a bar in order to get a 10% mass savings. So in the human exploration research analog missions, the HERA missions, we were doing that this year. For all four missions, we replaced their breakfast meal with the bars, and we were looking at how much they were consuming every day. So the ISS Fit app that Scott and Sarah Zwart developed was in those missions, and we were monitoring what they were eating every day, if they had weight changes, if they had comments on it based on health or psychology, and if they were eating less because they had to replace the meals with those bars. And so we're compiling that data right now, so hopefully we'll have some answers with that soon. And the idea was to look at, if you did this every day, what is your risk to crew members that they are going to eat less, that they are going to be very unhappy with the system, versus what is the number of days that you could replace a meal that would be just completely acceptable to a crew member.
So that means you're going to keep the same food system for future flights, correct? So there's how to select the food, how to pack them, how to, again, we reduce the mass, reduce the nutrition, adjust some menu for crew members, but the total of the system is going to be the same for long duration flights. That means for flights far from LEO to the Mars, for example.
The expectation right now is that the food will be prepackaged in single servings, and that's partially for safety, that's partially for crew time. Mm-hmm. So if we do have refrigeration and freezing capability and we can store the foods that way and they retain nutrition and acceptability, they'd still be safe if you lost it. So they could still eat the foods if they lost those capabilities. The part of, so we have looked at things like a bioregenerative food system and how would, you would implement that. The amount of crew time you would need would be very significant. You'd probably almost need to dedicate two crew members on that mission to a bioregenerative system. And you'd also have a risk of food scarcity, losing your crop. We've seen this even right now with growing some of the vegetables in space flight. It's very difficult. It's not an easy system. The watering system is very difficult. The nutrition system is very difficult. So now if you're dependent on that food system, you have a risk of not having the foods that you're going to need. And so we are looking at initial missions trying to stabilize a prepackaged food system for those exploration missions, that they can not have a risk of food scarcity, that they can prepare their foods very quickly. And then as the missions progress, we could test out the methodologies more for growing foods and integrating more of that into a system as you can grow a base on Mars.
Okay, David.
Yeah, Dave?
Sorry, I don't have a microphone, but you're using the word psychology a lot. It's driving me crazy. I'm not sure you understand how
psychological products.
Use it as an intermittent reinforcer. So they have to eat crap. They have to eat crap, whatever that
stuff is that doesn't taste good. And then they have a predictable time when they know they're going to get the good stuff. Do not fail to deliver the good stuff at the predictable time. In the 1950s, the Walter Reed studies regarding extreme sleep deprivation as torture, they weren't torturing people, they were looking at it in Americans to see how far they'd go. The one thing that determined explosive emotional reaction was a disappointment over food. So what you do is, as long as they know it's predictable and it's a reliable intermittent reinforcer, people will stretch themselves to get to that hedonic moment where they get something they like. Nansen, in his 3-year trip locked in the ice, which I still argue is the best historical event to look at if you want to go to Mars, he had to change course and not go directly over the North Pole because they were running out of food. That is exactly why he missed the North Pole. Now, he knew he missed it. He also had two chronometers fail, and he couldn't tell longitude, and he recovered from that. But by that point, the ice moving south, they could only turn back and never get to the North Pole. And then he got off and tried to walk to it. But he kept special, and I know you guys are nutritionists. For God's sake, send some junk food. In other words, send some dessert, send some stuff that the crew really loves to eat, and use that intermittently and celebrate the holidays and the birthdays with food. Use it smart. Use it. The timing is what matters about food, not just this stuff you're talking about. Okay? And if you forget that, sure, crews are going to be annoyed and they're going to be upset when they're disappointed. Those reactions are the normal human reactions to food. Food is intimate to culture. All cultures use food when they celebrate holidays or anything. There are special foods in virtually every culture around that. So just be sensitive to it and then use a good intermittent reinforcement strategy and a contingency plan and recognize that if something goes wrong with food or the crew's unhappy enough, particularly when they're autonomous, they may go rogue. The mission may change in terms of what's going to happen.
Just let me add a little bit.
So I wanted also to raise the other aspects of the nutrition, which is,
I think will be worth it to discuss. It is the use nutrition products to enhance and to strengthen colonial resistance against what I told yesterday, using as a source of nutrition products enriched with probiotics, enriched with autoprobiotics. I must say that now on ISS there are several experiments on Russian segment. It was very successful. I think that it's a discovery. Concerning the full cycle of lactobacilli fermentation of milk. So it opened a new direction. It's opened a new direction to use the fresh sour milk products as a source of as a nutrition products to enhance the colonial resistance of cosmonauts, which is weakened and suffered independence of the duration of the crew. And now we plan on the next year to make an experiment which is trying to adapt the existing technologies mainly concerning the liquid products, the packages for liquid products, to use it as a source for preparation of sour milk products. The other problem, which has arised by Dr. Kotov, a very interesting aspect, is concerning the utilization of the packages. And it's one of the future missions, especially with the missions to Mars, where there will be not progresses, which will burn in the dense layer of atmosphere, is to use biodegradable packages and to develop biodegradable packages to avoid such situations which described by Dr. Kotov. And the third problems, which is also, I must say, as a head of the department in which the nutrition lab belongs to, is the one of the prospective is elaboration of special food ratio for each of the stage of the missions, including the docking, undocking, loading, unloading mission, EVA, and certain others. I think that it is also a very prospective aspect to develop. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, but I need to reinforce the speech of my colleague Dinges. We really hate the word psychology is used by the technicians because it's easier, much easier to invite psychologists to discuss the psychological aspects. First of all, what he's saying, that you must not follow the taste and wish of every person, every time. This is a wrong approach in general. There must be ordinary days and holidays. So it's not the target to provide the person he wants every day. The target is to provide him with vitamins, minerals, carbohydrates, and so on, proteins. That's the primary task you have to follow. And that means that if you need to reduce weight, you need to use that bars and let it be bars for 6 days a week. But one day, just one day a week, you must have a choice. And that choice must be individual and culturally based. Because in Mars 500, we had a big problem with one of the crew member. He could not get the food he get used to. He was eating in his village where he was grown up, the certain food, and for him tea was nothing like we can buy in the shop. So that must be holidays. In this case, people will be happy, but they will be happy rarely. Nobody wants to be happy all the time. Oh, he will not differentiate ordinary day from the holiday. So again, matching their wishes is not the way. You have to find the proper combination of giving enough calories and enough immune strength, as my colleague Ilian is mentioning, the probiotics, for example, and psychological aspect. But psychological aspect is the top of the pyramid only. And do not try to do it by your own. Invite psychologists. They will tell you how much of the holiday you have to give and how much you have to meet the requests of the certain person. And finally, that you didn't mention at all, you all the time talking about the intracranial pressure, but you do not mention that taste is changing while in space because a lot of blood is coming to your tongue. So the preference on Earth and the preference in flight could be absolutely different. So it's not about changing of the crew member. It's about of the change of my own taste during the flight. And my requirements could be very different on a different stage of the flight, as Dr. Ilian is saying. So again, you have to manage to find the proper combination and to establish priorities. And not to rely only on technologies. If my grandchildren will go to the shop in 10 years, they will not find the real vegetables. They will not find the real strawberries. And that means that the whole population of Earth is now changing their tastes, and they forget how it has to be, how it has to smell, and how it has to taste. And this is important. So don't forget that the vision of food is also important, not the texture only. So it was said about the table on ISS. Think about how to make this table beautiful, how to make plates beautiful. This is also important, the surrounding around food that will make that taking of meals not just like in the village farm. It must be something like a restaurant. Think about that, not only about the texture and about the weight.
Thank you. And I would like to offer that. I really appreciate these comments because I think it, and Leroy, what you said in terms of the, I think the attitude of the crew, the shift that's going to have to happen for a mission like that. But I will say that I know what's going on in this food lab, and I know that the kinds of considerations that you just mentioned are happening all the time. The presentation of the food, the taste of the food, not just the texture, not just even what was being described as the psychological aspects of it, maybe wrongly using the term, I don't know. But these things are happening within our food lab. And I've seen those changes myself even, and it existed already. But I think as we close on this, I think what we're finding is that there is a huge...
I think Walt has a...
Oh, I'm sorry, Walt. Go ahead.
That's good.
Okay, go.
No, I just this wanted to see if we could get a comment from Tom Stafford, in that he flew in a spacecraft that was limited in the volume and very much limited, and they had a food system that was really not optimum. And maybe you could comment, Tom, on how that worked out for you.
Well, while you're giving him that, let me just ask a simple question. This has been very interesting. I'm talking about the ingredients and the attitude and adjusting to this. I've not heard one mention here about calories. Is that no longer a factor in your planning, or you just let that go by however it is, the calories? Is that not a factor in your planning on the meals anymore?
Oh, no, it is.
Calories are absolutely a factor. And if anything, calories are the number one factor, that if you're not...
Right now.
If you're not getting enough calories, you're not maintaining your weight, things are going wrong.
Yes, but is that part of your planning on the menus and the diets for the people?
So right now, the way we have this standard menu that's packed in 8 categories on station. So we pack all the meats together, all the veggies together, etc. We determine a usage rate for that. It is based on the caloric requirements of the 3 USOS crew members who are consuming from our half of the food system. So right now, I would say, yes, calories is the number one thing.
Okay. Do you do the tracking by individuals, and what is that level of calories? They used to try to impose on us 2,200 calories, I can remember, per person.
So it's calculated from an equation, and Scott can address that, because the caloric requirements that we receive come from Scott's nutritional biochemistry lab. They tell us what the combined caloric requirement for the 3 USOS crew members will be during that expedition, and that's how we calculate the usage rate for the food, and that's how we plan how much food to send for that group.
And just to go back to the basic point, when we meet with crews before flight, I tell them that if there's one thing I can tell you, it's that you've got to eat, that you've got to get enough calories to maintain your weight. And if you're doing that, almost everything else will come along, that you've got to get those calories.
I still haven't heard a number.
There's not a number. It's based on per person. We use a standard equation that takes into account your body size, your age, your gender. But
How much did you have for me? Because I talked to you a lot about it.
I didn't commit that to memory.
Come on.
You know, for us, at the low end, we see around 2,000 calories. At the high end, we've seen larger males up to 3,300, 3,400, 3,500 calories a day.
The baseline for shuttle, I think, was 2,700. I think that was it per crew member. And I think now it does flex, but you do it as a composite of all.
Right, we do it as a composite.
32, 33 baseline.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, from what I've heard here, we're talking about a five-star restaurant.
Yeah.
Compared to what we had.
Compared to what you had,
believe me. And I know on my first missions of one day, did the first rendezvous in space with Wally Schirra. The environmental control system, the way the radiator stripes were on it, didn't work too well. We were way too hot. We sweated and all that. And I just wasn't that hungry. I lost nearly 10 pounds. Mm-hmm. Second one, we did a lot of work on Gemini 9. But I just made up my mind, drink water, drink water, drink water, eat, eat, eat. And I think I lost 3 or 4 pounds. I went to the moon and back. Same thing on the way back. I loaded up. And I think I lost maybe a pound. Apollo Soyuz, I really loaded up. And I gained 1.5 pounds. But it was just force, you know. But the food got better all the time. But believe me, you're talking five-star compared to what we had.
Yeah, and I think we feel that way, too, which is why I think an important part of the conversation is, you know, the shift, what's coming from the audience. Leroy, what you mentioned, all of you in some way have hit on this, that there's, that, you know, I use the word revolution. I think it really is we have to kind of step back and look at it from a totally new perspective about how we're going to approach the way we eat, we go to the bathroom. I mean, all of it is going to be a little bit different when we're going on the way to Mars. And some of that is going to be within the astronaut office. It's going to have to be a big shift in how we think about those basic needs being satisfied for us as we fly longer and farther and, you know, away. And I'm really happy we had this discussion today. I hope it opens it up for more discussions and bringing the international community together to continue the discussion, and within the whole community, all of the interested parties to participate in. And I look forward to seeing how we ultimately modify our food system for both the nutritional and the true psychological aspects that can feed into it to make it a successful system. Thanks, everybody, for taking part. Thanks.